Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the fabulous Living Arts Center and a very special evening for a very, very special gentleman. I'm proud to call Oscar Peterson my very good friend, and I'm so delighted to be a part of this tribute tonight for this icon from the genre we lovingly call jazz. Oscar has inspired and dazzled us all with his musical talents throughout a career that has spanned six decades, and he's still going strong. So, check it out, see what some of these names do for you. Ella, Dizzy, Basie, Lady Day, Nat King Cole, Satchmo. How about Duke Ellington, Roy Eldridge, Fred Astaire, Frank Sinatra? And these are just a few of the incredibly talented people that Oscar has recorded, toured, and performed with over all these years. And tonight we're gonna hear some of that music that we've all come to love, presented by an all-star cast of jazz greats. So, OP, why don't you just sit back with your beautiful family, relax, snap your fingers, and enjoy your friends playing the music that you helped create over these many long years. But before we get started, let's take a brief look at where this story all began. The year was 1925, and the bustling Saint-Henri section of downtown Montreal was where Oscar was born. He was the fourth of five children to West Indian parents, Danielle and Kathleen Peterson. It was a tightly knit, integrated community in the hub of the Negro District. Well, that's what they called it back then. French, Irish, Italians, families of every nationality, and everybody got along great.
The community was very, very sociable, very close in a sense. Put it this way, the black people sort of had their nucleus. And but the white people also, there wasn't really a boundary there, black against white.
The local community center and church played a very important part in the daily lives of the families growing up in the area.
My mom was a deeply religious person. Once a week on Sundays, maybe twice on Sundays, go to church. No two ways about it.
He loved music. He taught himself to play a little organ that he had on when he was a bosun on the boat. And that's what I think was ingrained in him. He decided that he wanted a musical family.
If you were black, living in Montreal, and lucky enough to have a job, then you were definitely working for the railway. Oscar's dad, Daniel, was a porter, and he was determined that his kids would grow up to enjoy a better life. And he saw music as an escape, a way out for his family. So while he was away for several days on runs to the West Coast, the family piano became not only a source of entertainment, but very serious study as well.
In those days, the idiot box wasn't invented. It was a big deal to have a radio, especially I'm talking of a lower income family. And he got the piano and he said, everyone has to learn the piano.
Well, I was curious about the instrument, you know, and once I got into it, I knew that I liked it.
Older sister Daisy, the most gifted at the time, became the family piano teacher and disciplinarian to the Peterson kids, with very strict orders from Dad that everyone had to practice their piano lessons every day while he worked the rails.
I nicknamed her Attila recently. she sort of enforced the rules he left for us.
An excellent student at school, Oscar, a bit of a loner then, experienced his first childhood crush when the grade four teacher entered the classroom and announced, "My name is Miss Pearlson." Oscar and the other boys never recovered.
Oscar was a very good student. He was excellent in all the subjects he was taught. No, he didn't mingle with the other children. I think it's because his intelligence was beyond them, and he seemed to enjoy his own company.
I think it was Miss Frost's class, maybe. I came away very lucky one year with 99.9% average. I said, "Dad, Dad, Dad." He said, "What is it?" I said, "Dad, look." And I gave him the report. He said, I got 99.9%. He looked at me and he said, you're not giving out any hundreds this year?
He learned classical music. But when he reached the age of about 13, 14, he began to go into jazz music. We didn't call it, I think we called it swing.
Ah, yes, the golden age of swing. At age 14, Oscar auditioned for a national amateur contest on the CBC and went on to win. This led to further radio and television appearances, and the youngster from Saint-Henri was starting to make a real name for himself, becoming a mini celebrity not only at school, but on the local jazz scene in Montreal as well. I'll come back to this fascinating story a little later, but right now, let's get this show underway. Ladies and gentlemen, performing excerpts from the 1962 recording of West Side Story by the Oscar Peterson Trio, would you please welcome the Randolph Academy of the Performing Arts. Give it up. A young Oscar Peterson discovered very quickly that he had the skills to be great, but a slight case of cockiness was developing which didn't please Dad at all. The incomparable Art Tatum solved that.
At one point, my dad thought I was becoming a little overseen with myself and whatever I could do pianistically, and he brought home a record of Art Tatum's. And it caused me, needless to say, all kinds of nightmares. I didn't play for a month. I didn't go near the piano for a month. I couldn't believe it. I thought it was two men playing.
Oscar recovered from the trauma and immediately recognized his new mentor at the keyboard. Tatum's influence on his own style became clearly evident, and the rest, as they say, is history. But the big test came when Oscar decided to confront the undisputed head of the household with his plan to leave school.
You mean to tell me you're going to leave high school to do what? I said, to play piano. He said, what do you mean play piano? I said, I want to play jazz piano. I want to be a jazz piano player. And he said, he was quiet for a few moments. And he said, no. He said, I can't let you leave school just to be another piano player. All kinds of those around. He said, if you want to tell me that you're going to leave to be the best piano player, no, I'll let you leave. Other than that, I don't want to hear it.
Out of your seats, folks, here's Oscar Peterson with his version of Chinatown.
By now, Oscar Peterson was becoming a household name in Montreal. And Montreal became known as the city of good times. The alcohol was flowing freely, even during Prohibition, and the nightclubs and dance halls were smoking. For black musicians, prejudice was a lot less noticeable than in the United States.
It was incredible. It was something to see and hear. And don't forget, Montreal at that point was pretty wide open. And as a result, they used to call it the Little Paris. And people would come up from the United States, from New York and wherever, Philadelphia and so forth, even just for a weekend. And a lot of musicians came through there. And they'd hang out there and make the rounds of the clubs and everything else. So it was a busy, busy city that way, entertainment-wise.
Oscar joined the popular Johnny Holmes Big Band and later formed the first trio in Montreal, playing in many clubs throughout the city. However, a gig at the Alberta Lounge would change his life forever. Famed impresario Norman Granz happened to be in town on business, and the story of his discovery during a cab ride back to the airport became legendary.
He was on his way to the airport to go back to New York or wherever he was going, and my broadcast was on. So he said to the cab driver, he said, yeah, it's a nice piano player. He said, who is he? And I said, you don't know who that is? No, I said, no, it's a record, isn't it? He said, no, it's not a record, it's a broadcast. I said, what do you mean it's a broadcast? He said, well, it's a broadcast from the Alberta Lounge. He said, you mean that that's going on right now? He said, yeah, take me there. He said, I want to hear this guy in person. So he came down to the lounge.
That chance meeting kick-started a promising career, a powerful partnership, but more importantly, a beautiful friendship that would last for over 30 years, and it was solidified very simply with a handshake.
He said, then I'm your man. We shook hands on it. And that was it. We had a handshake. It was no contract. He was my man. He was a brother, and he was everything I wanted in a friend, more so. And he helped me through not only the musical end of my life, but through some of the tougher personal things in my life. He would give me advice that I cherished.
When I return, we'll look at Oscar's stunning impact on the Big Apple with Norman Granz's Jazz at the Philharmonic. I must say, JATP, at the age of 14, for me, was probably the most profound impact of my entire life. But first, it's now my great pleasure to introduce our Master of Ceremonies for this evening. Would you please welcome CFRB News Talk 1010 radio host, John Donaby. Created the popular Jazz at the Philharmonic at Carnegie Hall in New York City. But convincing Oscar to appear on that bill as a surprise guest was not an easy sell.
And I said, you gotta be out of your head. I'm not gonna go out in New York and play with Coleman Hawkins and Roy Eldridge. And he said, if you really wanna know how good you are, there's the perfect test. And he said, I'll make a deal with you. If it doesn't go over, come back home, nothing's lost. On the other hand, if they like you, I will do my best to represent you, but at least come down and take your best shot. Because you know how many people would love to even get close to Carnegie Hall. So I said, okay, I'll do it. Thank God, yes, it worked beautifully for me. That's one thing I'll never forget.
Naturally, the critics were blown away, and Oscar took New York by storm. And soon after, he joined the Jazz at the Philharmonic and began touring and recording with some of the greatest jazz artists of our time. His impression of these icons of the era say it all.
It was kind of interesting because I got a chance to play with all of these great people that I admired only from hearing records or the odd appearance when they came to Montreal. It was incredible. And I love Nat. He's one of the most gentle men I've ever met. He inspired me with his wonderful style. And when I first had a trio, that's the way I wanted my trio to sound. Royalty. Duke Ellington epitomized royalty. Wherever he was, whenever he'd walk in a room, people would stop what they were doing and just sort of look. He had that kind of presence. Great talent. She had a different reading of songs than any other vocalist. Oh, Pops. Great fun. I enjoyed playing with him, recording with him. And he loved it. You know, he was the happiest man I think I've ever met. Most fun I've ever had playing two pianos. I loved him. He was fantastic. What is there to say what all that hasn't been said? It's overwhelming to see and hear and play with someone with that kind of talent. She had it all.
That duo with Ray Brown on bass at Carnegie Hall also became the start of another sensational performing partnership that would develop into one of the greatest jazz combos of all time. Herbie Ellis on guitar, the Oscar Peterson Trio toured for several years and recorded dozens of outstanding albums together.
He and Ray Brown invited me to play with them somewhere back east in their trio, and I did, and from that, they liked the way I played, so they took me with them. It was the greatest experience of my life. There's no doubt about it.
Well, we were three brothers, and inseparable. It just happened that way. Ray and I first got together that night at Carnegie. Herbie became the third brother in the group. We did everything together. You know, we'd get into trouble together. We'd play pranks on each other. We'd spend hours putting together this musical thing that thought we felt. It was always congenial, it was loving, it was musically dedicated to the form that we were in.
We loved each other, and we got along great. Ray and I had to work very hard because Oscar made all the arrangements. He didn't set out to, but he made them very difficult. I just tried real hard, and thank God I made it.
When we come back, a look at the man and his many accomplishments over an incredible six-decade career. But right now, let's take it back to John Donaghy and more of the great music of Oscar Peterson.
I've tried to use my music and my success, whatever it may be, to make Canada a more visible society in the arts field than it has been.
Not only has he become a world-class pianist and jazz great who has delighted audiences throughout the world, Oscar Peterson is also an accomplished composer, author, photographer, television host, award-winning dad, and a staunchly proud Canadian. With over 200 record albums to his credit and a list of industry awards and honors too numerous to mention, OP has graciously accepted another important role throughout his long career as Canada's unofficial goodwill ambassador. He's made his country as proud of him as he is of his country.
It tells me that what I've been trying to do over the years has been appreciated.
The best jazz instrumental soloist is?
Please, thank you, darling.
All right.
Oscar Peterson, Montreal 77, Oscar Peterson.
Great musician, a man who truly has brought recognition to himself and his country. Ladies and gentlemen, who else? Oscar Peterson.
Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the great, the incomparable Oscar Peterson.
This is a Canadian that left these shores, temporarily anyway. I've always wanted to feel wanted at home. I've always wanted to feel respected at home. And I've always wanted to feel honored at home.
On his many world tours, he has enhanced Canada's musical reputation abroad. At home, he is a champion of the equality.
You are now to assume the function of Chancellor of York University, to which you have been duly appointed, in which you have accepted.
Mississauga, all of us in the world of music would agree, Your recognition tonight of Oscar Peterson as the first inductee into your new Art Hall of Fame is a fitting tribute to a most deserving recipient.
I cherish this as much as I cherished my first Downbeat Award, if that tells you anything. And that was the first major prize, well, two prizes. My first Downbeat Award, my first Grammy, and of course, because it's so close to me, I have to say the Order of Canada also.
Myself wanted to be there this evening to applaud their friend and colleague at this very important event. But schedules and commitments in the hectic world of entertainment somehow got in the way. I'm sure you know what that's all about. So we did the next best thing. We took the camera to them and recorded their thoughts on your illustrious career while asking them about the monumental contribution and impact you've made to the world of music. And here's what they had to say.
Oscar Peterson is a great pianist, and he plays. He's very, very, very fast, and even his ballads are fast.
All of my friends thought that Oscar's sounded like the next Art Tatum, and Art Tatum was God. And here's this young kid out of Canada and making us all wonder, what's happening? This guy is so great.
What I think is so unique about Oscar is he takes all that technique, all that knowledge about music, and not just piano music, about music in general, puts it together and swings so hard, you're never unfulfilled at the end of an Oscar Peterson concert.
We know, number one, you're a great pianist. We know that going away. But it's that face, man. That's gold. When you sit down, man, you've got at least 88 teeth there. Oh, yeah. And you're looking out there in that audience and say, pay attention, please.
No matter what Oscar's playing, the blues is always there in some form or other. If not blues changes or blues notes, the feeling of blues, the feeling of jazz.
His influence went to all the places where I traveled, Japan, Australia, no matter where it was, there were always questions and what's Oscar doing now? And everybody admired him.
There ain't but a few left, and Oscar's one of the gems.
I know you're still going strong. And all that great piano, you brought so much joy to so many people. I hope you never get tired of hearing that. I paint to music, and I do a lot of painting, and I love art, and I listen to your music, seriously. I'm not just doing a number on you. I listen to your music. I listen to piano. I can handle it. The hard rock stuff. I can understand why people turn to drugs.
Now, whether or not I'm happy about his getting into this organization, I have mixed emotions because I've had an apartment in Kitchener and no one has ever offered to put me in the hall of anything.
I would just wish him to be around forever and take care of himself.
Oscar Peterson truly is a man of the world, a citizen of the universe.
OP, it's hard to succinctly put into words all of the feelings I have about you and the effect you've had on my life, which started way back in 1949. And I have ever been so grateful and proud to have shared so much these almost six decades being a disciple of yours, a friend of yours, a fellow dad. I've got six daughters, so you know, I understand. I used to remember that little expression you used to do with your, you shared with your little girl. And your influence is is worldwide, and there's nothing to say about it. Everybody knows, and I just wanted to tell you from the bottom of my heart, I'm happy to be alive and to have you in my life and deeply in my heart. And congratulations, my friend.